हेलो फोक्स, वेलकम बैक टू द यूपीरिया वर्ल्ड एंड आई एम अभिनय गुप्ता। सो टुडे अगेन वी आर कंटिन्यूइंग विद द वाइंडिंग अप ऑफ द कंपनीज रेफरिंग टू द प्रोविजंस ऑफ द कंपनीज एक्ट 1956। राइट, नाउ टुडे वी स्टार्ट विद अ डेविएशन। वी स्टार्ट विद सम फ्रेश टॉपिक्स इन वाइंडिंग अप। वी हैव डन अ लॉट ऑफ वाइंडिंग अप प्रोसीजर्स, राइट? द कंपल्सरी वाइंडिंग अप, वॉलंटरी वाइंडिंग अप, वाइंडिंग अप बाई सुपरविजन ऑफ द कोर्ट, द डिफंक्ट कंपनी, रिस्टोरिंग द नेम, अ लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स। All the procedures we have done. Now we come to something which is concrete. This lecture hence, we will start with the discussion of the important topics like the contributories, who are the contributories, what are the people, who are the people who are involved, what is a contributory, a lot of things about contributory. Then we go about with the preference of the payment, right? There are a lot of things, concrete things that we need to discuss now. Right? But be less assured, we will not take a lot of topic on this, we'll not take a lot of lecture on this. Because you just have maximum of 3-4 topics that are pending, right? The most important part of the winding up was actually the procedures of winding up. But by now, I hope you are very clear with all the procedures of winding up, right? That is struck in your brain very, very, very close, right? Now we go on to discuss those topics that we have been covering throughout. We have been referring to the contributories, for example, throughout our all the lectures, everywhere. I don't think there was any lecture where we did not refer to the contributory. Except, yeah, the defunct company and the restoration. Before that, when we are talking about the procedures, contributories were present overall. If nothing, then for filing the petition. If there is winding up, contributories have to bring in the payment. So we have been covering contributories throughout. But we have not seen what are the contributories, who are the contributories. Right, the provisions that are related to the contributories are still pending. So today in this lecture we'll make an effort that we understand who the contributories are, right? And since it is not a very small topic, that means we may take some time on this topic, so that may not or it may not be necessary that we cover up the entire contributory concept in this lecture. But if there are a little bit that is pending, we'll take it up in the next lecture along with the questions that we need to discuss. Right? Yeah, over here, because this has been given in your examination a lot of time, right? The examiner has tested you on this topic a lot of times. So we will discuss one or two questions on this as well, right? But otherwise, we know that all the questions are to be dealt with later on. We'll deal with all the questions relating to this chapter after this chapter has come to an end, right? So with that, we start with the lecture today, keeping the core of the lecture surrounding around the contributories. So when we talk about contributories, one very important thing is to understand who the contributories are. We have been referring to them throughout the lectures, but we still don't exactly know who the contributories are, right? Although I have already explained it when we are discussing the lectures, we have already explained by their nature, by their activity, we know who they are, right? So let us see the meaning in a list, in a line, to see what the contributories are, who they are. Right, so the contributories are person liable to contribute to the asset of the company. So what do you mean by that? Who are the people who are liable to contribute to the asset of the company? The company itself, the management, right? Now who are these contributories? So basically, try and understand what are the assets of the company. Assets do not necessarily mean the fixed assets, the plant, machinery, building, office, fixture, furniture of the company. No. Even debtors are assets. Do you agree? So if somebody owes something to the company, they are contributing to the asset of the company. So they are contributories. Right? That is one way of seeing that, yes, contributories does not only mean the people who have given those substantial assets to the company. If there is anybody who has some due to the company, they are called contributories to the company. They will contribute to that fund of the company. When we talk about asset, even cash is an asset. So these are the people who contribute to that fund of the company, right? So these will basically include the holders of any shares, those shares which are fully paid, right? They are contributors, they are members of the company. At any point of time, if we need that, no, the company needs some more funds to sustain or something more, we can call those people, right? That we want some contribution from your end, this is necessity. And when they give us the contribution, their share increases, and what happens is they get more return. So they are willing to contribute in that end. Or if they are the debtors of the company, we'll say that listen, we need the payment very urgently because we need some money in the company, we need some investments. So the debtor, they call off the debtor pays. That is the due of the debtor. Debtor pays the due, they are contributories. Right? Contributories can be the present, past, any member. Yeah. We'll see in detail when are the past members covered and what happens and everything. It is an interesting topic. Right? Just stay tuned when we step one by one, we take one by one rung of that ladder to the entire concept of contributory. Right? Another one important thing when you that you need to understand in the beginning of this lecture is that contributories are also the elect contributories. Elect or alleged, whatever you call it. Right? So before the list is final, before we determine that whether or not the person is a contributory, right, all the people who are suspected to be contributories will also be considered to be contributories. Right? Because they may turn up to be contributories, they may not turn up to be contributories, but as on date they are still lying in that pipeline that is leading them to be the contributory. They are alleged to be the contributories, suspected to be the contributories. Right? So even those people will be considered contributory for section 428. Right? For section 428 actually defines the meaning of the term contributory. And the entire list of sections that we will be dealing with under the topic of contributory would range from section 428 to section 467. Yeah, not all the sections, but yeah, all the sections that you will be covering will be between these two numbers. Right? So okay, we understand who are contributories. We got the meaning of contributories, right? But when do we use this term? Basically, this term is used in the process of winding up. We are now dealing with the chapter winding up of the companies, right? So when we are referring to contributories, we are referring to contributories in context of winding up. So in winding up, the court has to prepare a list that okay, these are the contributories. They have to dispense with the list of contributories. So when the court is preparing the list of contributories, the court will prepare two lists. List A of contributories and list B of contributories. Right? So list A of contributories would contain the name of those members who are presently the members of the company. Right? That means the members whose names are appearing in the register of the member. And it is appearing in the register of the member as on the date of the commencement of the winding up of the company. So when the court orders winding up, when the winding up is initiated, it will call for the list for the register of the member, and all those people whose name are there, they will all be considered to be contributories. That means if there is any member who has already given his share to someone else, but that other member or the receiver of that share, his name is not registered, then we would consider the older member to be the part of that list. That means even he will continue to be the contributory unless and until the new member gets registered. Right? And then you have the list B contributories. The list B would basically contain the name of the past members. Right? Now who are the past members? Past members are the people who were the members of the company, whose name was into that register of the member at one point of time, but now they have sold away all their shares in the company. So their name has been removed. And someone else has taken the place of their name because they have taken the shares from those people. Right? But do you think you call away all the past members of the company? That means anybody who ever in their life had taken any share of this company and the name was registered in the list of, or name was registered in the register of members, will you call every one of them? Will all of them be a part of the list? No. We will only consider those members who have been a part of the company, who have been the member of the company within the preceding 1 year, and that 1 year will be seen from the date of commencement of winding up. Right? And again, remember one more thing, that the contributories need not necessarily be contributories in their own rights. Even if they are representative of some other people, they will be considered to be contributories. Like, for example, any legal representative of the deceased member. Someone has died and then he has left behind a legal representative. So if we have any communications to be made, if we have any payment to be given, any dividend to be given, we'll be giving it to the official or legal representative of that member. So that legal representative is actually representing that member. So when we cannot include that member into that list, we will include his legal representative. right? So contributories can be contributories in their own term as well as a representative of the member, right? Both of them are contributories. And remember, it is not necessary for the court to prepare this list and then call for the money. No, the court can also dispense with this list, no preparation of the list, if it thinks that no contribution would be required from the contributory in the process of winding up. And since you have completed the entire chapter of winding up, you know when is the situation arising, when the company actually has sufficient fund. And generally, this situation would be more apparent to see in the member's voluntary winding up, because over there either you do not have any debt or you have enough surplus to pay off all the debts and liabilities, right? So these are the two separate lists of contributories that are prepared by the court, right? So when the court has prepared this list, why has it done so? It has done so because these contributories will now be required to contribute in the assets of the company in the course of winding up. Right, that means they are liable to contribute to the company. So now let us see what are the nature of liability of the contributories. So if we look at the nature of contributories liability, then we have four basic categories of nature. One is absolute liability, fresh cause of action to the liquidator, ex lege liability, and liability arises only when such calls are made to him. Did you understand anything? No. Because this is not the general term that you have been referring to in the other lectures of the chapter. There is something that we are hearing for the first time. What is absolute liability? What is ex lege liability? Let us see. Why am I here? I will explain all these four topics to you individually. So the first topic over here, that is the absolute liability. Let us see what is the absolute liability. So let us first remove the other three from the screen. Now we are discussing only about the absolute liability, right? So when we talk about absolute liability, try and understand the word absolute, right? That means that the liability of that contributory is created by law. You cannot say that it is a dicey situation whether or not I will have to contribute. No. If you are asked to contribute, you will have to contribute because your liability is created by law. It is not because of any action of yours. That okay, if you do this, you will be liable. If you don't do this, you will not be liable. No. If the law says that you need to contribute, that means it is your absolute liability to contribute. But if the law does not require for your contribution, you are not required to contribute. So when you talk about absolute liability, that means whatever amount the law wants you to bring in, you will have to bring in. Obviously, the law will not be unjustified, unreasonable on that. Right? If you have any call money pending, the law will demand for those call money only. That is your absolute liability. You know the exact amount of your liability and you know that when is it to be paid. Right? So basically, this is a liability which is created by law. Although this is your statutory due, that okay, you are indebted to the company. Right? You are the debtors for the company in this situation, if we say. That okay, if the shares are worth rupees 10 and you have paid up 8, then 2 is the call money that you actually owe to the company, although you have not given it now, although the company has not made the call, but you owe that money to the company. That is a statutory debt that you have, right? But that amount becomes payable only when the court makes an order for the calls, right? So when the court says that okay, we do not have surplus asset to pay off all the liabilities, so we will need the contributories to contribute their share. So what is your share? Your share is the unpaid call amount. Right? So when the court makes that order that yes, you need to bring in that money, that you need to make that contribution, you need to contribute your share of money, then understand that you will have to bring in that money. And who will call that money from you? That will be the duty of the liquidator. The court will make the order, the liquidator will come up to you. Say, bro, you have this amount pending for this shares of yours. Please bring in the money. And since it is your absolute liability, you will have to bring it. There is no case that you will say, okay, maybe I am excluded. Please look at the provision. Maybe there is some conclusion, some condition over there. No, nothing. If you have been asked to contribute, you have to contribute. That is your absolute liability. Right? So that is all about absolute liability. Now we go on to the next nature, that is the fresh cause of action to the liquidator. Now, what do you mean by the fresh cause of action? For this, I'll give you an example. Now consider that the company was functional, right? It has not yet gone into the process of winding up. So the company was functional, the company was functioning very well. And during its operation, the company feels that yes, now it is time and the company needs to call, to make call on the shares or the payment due on the shares. Right? So what does the company do? This company makes a call to all the shareholders that yes, maybe rupees 2 is pending on your share. So we are making the call, please pay rupees 2 per share that you have. Right? And now the company could not take this process ahead with success. That means those people, those shareholders, they did not pay their call money within due time. And that suit of the company, that the company had made a call and they filed to the court that yeah, these are the amount pending from the contributories or from those shareholders, that suit had become time barred. That means although you started or you initiated the call, but the call money was not ultimately received due to any reason. Right, that is not our concern because that is during the operations of the company. What we are basically concerned over here is the winding up portion. Right, so prior to winding up, you had made a call, you did not receive the money, whatever be the reason. Right, but now when your winding up has started, when the liquidator has come, that would be the fresh cause of action. That means whatever has been in the past, the liquidator is least bothered, is least concerned about that. Now the liquidator will make a fresh call. And then you will be liable to pay to the liquidator. No matter whatever was the case, whatever was the conclusion earlier, the liquidator is least bothered, is least considered. If the court has prepared a list and you are falling in the list A or list B of the contributory, and now the liquidator makes a call to pay the undue, to pay the due call, the money that is still due from on your end, which is your statutory debt, right, then you will have to abide to that order of the liquidator. You cannot say that, okay, initially the company had asked and we did not pay because this was the reason, that was the reason. No, we are not concerned with anything. When the liquidator comes into play, now it is the liquidator's company. Now it is that fair ground, the fight, the ring for the liquidator. And you are facing the liquidator. The company is in the background. The directors have already lost their power. Right? Nobody. You initially fought with some other fighter. There was some other boxer in the ring. Now it's the liquidator. If you want anything, face the liquidator. Right, so liquidator gets the fresh right to enforce the payment of the unpaid call. Right, and this right of the liquidator is independent of the right of the company. Right, maybe the company had the right, or maybe there was a suit, there was a proceeding, and as per the order of that, the company lost its right to call for that call money due. Due to any reason, right, we are not getting into it, that is a very detailed concept. Let's leave it. Due to any reason, the company could not make that call. Now the company is not authorized to make that call, right? But if the liquidator comes into play, company is out of the box. Company is out of the scene. If the contributory comes and says that no, we discussed with the company and then we had a case also on the same matter and the company cannot call for those call money. The liquidator says, forget about the company. Face me. I have the right to make that call. If you have anything, go and challenge me to the court. Right? Why? Because now the liability of the contributories have changed after the order of winding up has been given. So as per their new liability, the liquidator gets the fresh cause of action. Right? Try and understand that the liquidator will always make the call, no matter what had happened in the company. That is the basic nature of liability that we are talking about. Right? I hope it is clear with you. The next nature that we will be considering is the ex lege liability. Now this is a Latin term, right? When we talk about ex lege liability, that means it is a liability according to the law, right? The liability of the contributories, basically, it is never an ex contractu liability, which means if it is not ex contractu, that means it is not a matter of a contract. That means, yes, you will say that, okay, I'm a contributory. If I had a contract and whatever is the term of the contract, according to that, I will pay. So you don't necessarily have a contract. If you are a member, you have purchased the share, right? We will not go by the terms of the contract. Okay, what was the contract you had signed? What is the provision over there? When will you be liable? No, we will not look into the contract because the liability of the contributories are not ex contractu. Contractu, the ex contractu, it is a Latin term, right, for the contract. Right? So it is not a matter of contract. So we will not be referring to a contract. You come and you say, no, I had a dealing with the company and I will not be supposed to make this payment because I have made some other payments to the company. Look at my contract that I have. No, we are not referring to any contract because your liability is not ex contractu. Your liability is ex lege liability. Right? And when we talk about the ex lege liability, that means your liability is a matter of law. Which means we don't refer to any contract. Just the mere fact that your name is registered in the register of the member, right? Because the register of the member is created as per law. And when your name is registered in the register of the member, then the law says that you are the contributory, that you are the holder of the share. You stand in the list of contributory. And now if we are making any call, then your nature becomes absolute liability and you have to make that payment to us. Right? In absolute liability, we saw that when the law, when the court demands that payment, you'll have to make that payment. Otherwise, you don't have to make the payment. Right? It is a statutory debt, but payable only when the call is made. And in ex lege, we see that we can go ahead and make the call to you just because of the mere fact that your name has been registered in the register of member. Now, say for example, Mr. A had taken the shares from the company and his name appeared in the register of the member. Now, before the procedure of winding up started, Mr. A sold his share to Mr. B. But the name of Mr. B was not adjusted in the register of the member. That means in the register of the members, still the name that appears is the name of Mr. A. The shares have not been transferred to Mr. B as per the register of the company. Right? So whom will the liquidator make that call? The liquidator will make that call to Mr. A. Why? Because his liability is ex lege. That means as per law. And as per law, whatever is whosever name appears in the register of the members is liable to pay as contributories. No matter what contract you had with anybody else or with the company. Right? But again, since that is an undue pressure on the contributory, who is no more a contributory basically, Mr. A, because his shares have been transferred. So in that case, there is a remedy that even the court has the right to amend that register. So what you do is you go to the court and you say, listen, I am no more the member of this company. The shares have already been transferred to Mr. B, but the register has not been updated. So the court will now update the register and hence now his name is out of the register and the law will not be enforceable on him. And the name of Mr. B is included in the register and hence the law will be enforceable on Mr. B. Right? So are you clear with the term ex lege liability? That the liability is not arising as a matter of contract, but it is arising as a matter of law. And your register is prepared by the law. And hence whosoever name is there in the register is liable to pay. Clear with that? And the last nature that we need to discuss over here is the liability arises only when such calls are made to him. Okay, like the case of absolute liability, similar to that. That once the call is made, you have an absolute liability of payment. That is the absolute liability. But over here what it says that your liability will arise only when the call is made. Otherwise, you don't have any liability to contribute. Right? So, when is the call made? Basically, that is what we need to understand. The call is made when the assets of the company fall short of the liability. That means maybe you have 10 crores of assets but 15 crores of liability. So 5 crore liability is something that you cannot pay by disposing of your assets. Right? So for that 5 crore amount, what you do is you make the call. Or you ask the contributories to make the payment. Right? So the liability of the contributory will only arise when that call for 5 crore is made. Or obviously not a single person is going to pay that 5 crore. It is as per the distribution. As per your share in the contribution. Right? Now, what are the situations when the call can be made by the liquidator? One is that we have seen that yes, the call will be made when the company falls short of the assets. The liabilities are more than the assets of the company. Right? Also, the call can be made for any adjustment of the rights of the contributories. Now, what do you mean by adjustment of the rights of the contributories? Now consider the example that there are 4 contributories, Mr. A, B, C and D, right? And Mr. A and B have contributed more than what they were required to contribute into the funds of the company. So now it is the reverse, that the company, that they have become the receiver, right? So maybe these four people together had to bring rupees 4 crore, and A and B bought 3 crore, and C and D combined they bought 1 crore, 50 lakhs. So now C and D will be made. The call will be made on C and D to bring back, to bring more 1 crore that can be paid off to A and B, so that the liability of each, like each one of you, have bought equal money that was due to you, that was due to the company from you, right? So even for that adjustment among the contributors also, you make the call at times, right? So what are the sum that you are supposed to pay? So basically, if you are falling short of that asset to pay off the liabilities, and for as per our example, rupees 5 crore was still pending, so the sum that you need to bring in is that 5 crore, which will be sufficient to pay off that debt and liability, right? Plus, you will also bring certain other amount that is required for the cost, charges and expenses of the winding up. It is an administrative task, right? The liquidator is going on to handle a lot of procedures, performing a lot of procedures, going into some legal task as well. So that requires expenditures, right? So please understand that when it requires expenditures to be made on the part of the liquidator, that is the cost of liquidation. And when you do not have enough money to pay off all your debts, that means how do you have the money to pay off your cost? So when you are called for that money, you are called for the unpaid liabilities, the liabilities that are not settled, or also that means as well as together with it, you will be called money for the cost of the liquidation. And then along with it, if at any point of time we have that, yes, some contributories have paid more amount than what was liable, what they were liable for, as compared to the other contributories who do not pay. So those other contributories will also be called for more money so as to set off this difference, right? So for the adjustment of the rights of the contributories among themselves also, another amount will be raised from the contributories, right? So basically there are three amounts that will be clubbed and raised. One is the amount for which the debt, the assets fall short of liability. Second, the cost of liquidation. And third, to set off the rights of the members, right? So that was all about the liabilities that we need to discuss. It was a little heavy topic, I know, because we have not dealt with such terms earlier in the lecture, but that is why I went slow with it, right? So if you remember, what is the absolute liability? Absolute liability says that although it is your statutory due, but it will become payable only when the order is made for the call. Fresh cause of action to the liquidator means whatever had happened earlier with the company, we don't care. When the liquidator comes in, he has the authority to make the call. So although you had won a case against the company that you will not be supposed to pay or something, we don't care. Now you will have to pay because the liquidator is a new person altogether. Then you have the ex lege liability. That means your liability is construed by law. It is as per law that you are liable to pay. That means as per law, you have the contract, you have the register of the members that is prepared as per law. As per law, your name is entered over there. So as per law, you will have to pay. There may be a truth behind that you are no more the registered holder of the share. It has been transferred to Mr. B. But since in the register of the members, your name appears, that means you have the liability. So please go to the court and get the registered amended, so that your liability comes to an end and liability shifts to Mr. B, right? So it is not ex contracto, it is ex lege liability. And the last is that the liability arises only when such calls are made. So although you are liable to pay, but if the company has enough surplus, enough assets to pay off the liability, they will not call for your money, right? But if they do not have, if the liability exceeds the asset, your money will be called. And if that happens, then you will also be called for the cost, because if they're not able to pay off the liability, that means they're not able to meet the cost of liquidation, right? And also for the settlement of the rights among the other members also, you may be called for some money for the adjustment of the rights of the contributories, right, among themselves. So that was basically the nature of the contributories liability, right? So since that was already a heavy topic, we will put an end to the lecture over here. And the remaining part of the contributory, right, that means we'll be discussing basically about the persons who are liable to be the contributories. There's a list, right? I show you a gist of that list in the class over here. This is the entire list. So we'll be discussing about this list in the next class, in the next lecture, right? And also that there is no right to set off If you are paying something to the company and you also want something from the company, what you have to do is first you make all the payment and then stand in the list as per the preference you will be given your money. Right? What is the rationale behind it and everything? We'll be discussing it into the next lecture. Right? So until then, this is Abhinay Gupta signing off. Stay tuned for the next lecture. Thank you. Bye-bye.